Welcome to Manglish Medical Lectures. Notes will be available in the Telegram channel. So today we'll be doing a pathology, pneumonia, lung pathology, pneumonia. So let's begin. So before going into pneumonia, we'll discuss the normal anatomy. Normal anatomy padichittu namukku rogathilekku pogam. So in normal anatomy, you can see the trachea giving off the right and left bronchus. It is undergoing progressive division and it is forming terminal bronchioles, right? From the terminal bronchiole, it again divides. It gives off the respiratory bronchiole, which then gives off an alveolar duct and an alveolar sac. So what do we have? We have an alveolar sac, we have an alveolar duct, and we have a respiratory bronchiole. And all these three combined is known as what? A sinus. So keep that definition in your mind. Now we'll move to the histological transition. Enganeyana histology maarunathu? So you can see the respiratory epithelium in the trachea, that is the ciliated pseudo stratified columnar epithelium. That is our respiratory epithelium, pseudo stratified columnar epithelium. And we can also find goblet cells in the respiratory epithelium inside trachea and bronchus. So this is the epithelium of trachea and bronchus. Now we move to the submucous layer. And what do we have in the submucous layer? We have the submucous glands. We have submucous glands in the trachea and bronchus. And then we have cartilage. Presence of cartilage is also characteristic. Now we are moving to, this was trachea and bronchus. Now let's see the change in bronchioles. In bronchioles, the epithelium is undergoing a change. It is becoming more cuboidal in nature. The cilia is decreasing in number. You can see the cilia is dropping in number and the goblet cells are absent. That is the epithelial changes. Now we move to the other layer, submucous layer, and we find the glands are absent. We also find that the cartilage is also absent, but there is presence of smooth muscles. So this is the situation of bronchioles. Now we move to the final transition, that is alveoli. In the alveoli, we have two types of cells, a very flat cells known as type 1 pneumocytes and a circular with oval nucleus type 2 pneumocytes. So this is the type 1 pneumocytes which are taking part in the gaseous exchange, and this is the type 2 pneumocytes which secrete surfactants. Lined by these two cells are the alveolar cavity. So this is the normal anatomy of the lungs. Idana the normal anatomy. Now we move to the risk factors which can trigger a pneumonia. The important ones are loss of local defense mechanisms, that is a loss of cough reflex. Number two, you can have a dysfunction of the mucociliary apparatus. What is mucociliary apparatus? In the respiratory epithelium, the cilia will push the antigen or the bacteria up to the throat. So you can either ingest it, it goes to the stomach, HCl it dies, or you can spit it out, goes out through the mouth. This is the mucociliary apparatus, this constant upward motion. This can be undergoing a defect. For example, in viral infection, when you're having a viral infection, what happens? This virus can shed this respiratory epithelium and the ciliary dysfunction can occur, or there is a decrease in the function. You can lose this mucociliary protective mechanism. So that can be a risk factor. Number three, increased secretions, like for example in cystic fibrosis, you're having more secretion, there's a more chance of inflammation being elicited. Number four, you can have edema and congestion, where you can have RBCs and polymorph nuclear cells coming out, like neutrophils are coming out to the lung or alveolar space. So the fifth one is alveolar macrophage dysfunction. The macrophage is very sad because it cannot phagocytose enough. There is a drop in the phagocytic activity of the alveolar macrophages, which can also result in defense mechanism loss. So these are the factors compromising the local defense mechanisms. Now we'll talk about types of pneumonia. Pneumonia is actually infection of the lung parenchyma. So inflammation or infection of the parenchyma, it can be in the interstitium, sparing the alveolar cavity, or it can be in the alveolar cavity causing consolidation. Consolidation is what? Air is getting replaced by something else. It can be a fluid in the alveoli. Clear? Now classification. Typical pneumonia, atypical pneumonia. Typical consists of lobar pneumonia, bronchopneumonia. Atypical is interstitial pneumonia. These are the three classifications. So what happens in lobar pneumonia? In lobar pneumonia, the consolidation is getting confined to a particular lobe or an entire lobe. In broncho pneumonia, you have patches of consolidation usually affecting the smaller airways. We'll discuss it further down. Then interstitial pneumonia, typical pneumonia, you have increased lung markings in X-ray. How is it happening? If you look into the alveoli in an interstitial pattern, the interstitium is markedly affected, the alveolar sacs are very least affected, right? So this interstitial thickening causes increased marking. So atypically seen in viral infection, typical pneumonia is usually seen in bacterial infections. Now let's go to the pathogenesis of pneumonia. We have four steps. So this is the alveoli, this is the blood vessel. So in lobar pneumonia, you can see the congestion is happening. You can see the RBCs and the neutrophils are coming, exudate is formed. And what is happening? There is congestion. Step number one, congestion. Step number two, there is consolidation, there is increased RBC coming, and something known as red hepatization. What is mean by hepatization? It means the consistency of the lung is similar to liver. That is red hepatization. Understood? So we can also have the consolidation from the upper down. That is known as broncho pneumonia, from the smaller airways into the alveolar cavity. While in lobar, we are going from down to up. Now the third stage is gray hepatization, because the RBC is decreasing in number. RBC undergoing disintegration or destruction by the macrophages, right? This is the third stage of pathogenesis, gray hepatization, but the consistency remains the same. Now the fourth one is resolution. There is a decrease in the inflammation, there is phagocytic activity increasing, and the clearance of all the debris, which results in resolution, which is the most common outcome. And how do we attain this resolution? Because of the presence of type 2 pneumocytes, which are capable of regenerating these cells. So the four steps of pathogenesis is important: congestion, red, gray hepatization, and resolution. Now we move to the pores of corn. What are pores of corn? Okay, consider two alveoli. They are connected by pores of corn. So what happens? A consolidation infection gets spread to the other alveoli through the pores of corn. That is all about it. Comparison between typical and atypical pneumonia. Namukku avare compare cheyam. So in typical pneumonia, you have bacteria. They are mostly viral, but bacteria also present. Exudate is very high in typical. The cough is purulent in typical. It is non-purulent in atypical. These are very important points. Then high grade fever. You are usually having high grade fever and low grade fever in atypical pneumonia. And the next one we are discussing is aspiration pneumonia. What is aspiration pneumonia? So consider a person that is the trachea going to lungs. There is esophagus going to the GIT, right? So when we eat something, usually it goes to the esophagus. But when it goes to the trachea, we call it aspiration, right? And it usually goes to the right bronchus. But why? Why is it going to the right bronchus? Because the angle of branching is the factor. You can see the right bronchus is more favorable for an aspiration. So right lobe is mostly affected. Understood? And what are the conditions where you can have aspiration pneumonia? It can be a bedridden patient, it can be an alcoholic. So how is it happening? Actually, the flora in the oropharynx is getting aspirated into the lung, and that is causing the inflammatory response. And aspiration pneumonia is actually a subtype of broncho pneumonia. I'll explain the concept here. In lobar pneumonia, infection goes from the alveoli to the airways, up, down to up. The opposite takes place in broncho pneumonia, from the airways to the alveoli. An irritation is coming from the airway to the alveoli. Now coming to the clinical features of pneumonia. In typical pneumonia, you can have high grade fever with chills, you can have productive cough. So the sputum, it can be yellow color indicating a pus, it can be rusty color indicating blood. Another important is pleural involvement. You can have pleuritic chest pain. The patient complains of pain on inspiration because of the involvement of pleura. So now we move to seven pneumonia syndromes, which are pneumonia arising from distinct clinical settings. So number one is community acquired pneumonia. You're going to a marriage, a shopping mall, and you get a pneumonia. That is community acquired pneumonia. Number two is healthcare associated pneumonia. Healthcare associated pneumonia. Number three is hospital acquired pneumonia. I will explain the differences. Aspiration pneumonia, we already described. Then chronic pneumonia, then necrotizing or lung abscess. And the last one is pneumonia in an immunocompromised host. What is the difference between 2 and 3, healthcare and hospital acquired pneumonia? Actually, it depends on how long you are in the hospital. For example, if you are a bedridden patient, you are staying weeks and months in the hospital and you get a pneumonia, that is hospital acquired. But you are in for a hospital for a very small procedure like wound dressing and then you get pneumonia 2 to 3 days after that, that is your healthcare associated pneumonia. I hope the difference is clear. Then lung abscess can mature into cavitation. Now the most common cause of community acquired pneumonia is strep pneumonia or pneumococci. And if you are having a jelly like sputum, you should doubt a Klebsiella pneumoniae infection. Another pneumonia is pneumonia associated with hemolytic anemia. It is seen with mycoplasma. You should remember that mycoplasma is the causative organism for atypical pneumonia or otherwise known as interstitial pneumonia. Now you are having a pneumonia that is from a veterinarian setup like animal placenta involved or a pneumonia in the dairy farm, then you should doubt a coccidia infection. What is this terminology known as secondary pneumonia? Secondary pneumonia is bacterial pneumonia superimposed on a viral pneumonia. The person undergoes a viral pneumonia, is immunocompromised, then bacterial pneumonia takes over. Okay, so here is a bonus point. SARS-CoV-2 or the COVID-19 enter our lung cells utilizing the ACE2 receptors on the lung epithelial cells. And then what does it cause? It causes ARDS, respiratory distress. So remember ACE2. Now in the X-ray here you can see pneumonia. You can see the lobe. It is a lobar. It is most likely to be a lobar pneumonia. You can see the patch or the consolidation in the shape of a lobe. So that white color is actually nothing but consolidation. Understood? So now we'll talk about some histology aspects of pneumonia. Now let's discuss the normal histology first so that we can understand the pathology. Okay, understand the concepts. These are alveolar spaces, right? And the alveolar space or the alveolar cavity is lined by type 1 and type 2 pneumocytes. So this is how a normal alveoli will look. So the person is undergoing pneumonia. You can remember the steps of pathogenesis. Congestion is taking place, right? So inflammation. Consolidation, the cavity is filled with inflammatory infiltrate, right? You can see the polymorphonuclear cells infiltrating. So this is what you see in lobar pneumonia or bronchopneumonia, right? So what will you see in interstitial pneumonia? The cavity will be very less involved, right? The interstitial will be markedly involved, right? You can see the lymphocytes all in the interstitial area, right? Where there will be very less involvement of the cavity. There will be involvement, there is no zero involvement, but there will be very less involvement of the cavity, right? So lobar pneumonia or bronchopneumonia, the condition is like that. If it is interstitial pneumonia, you will be getting this pattern. Very few infiltrate is seen in the cavity. So I believe now you are able to differentiate two histology diagrams if you get them. So that's it guys, thank you for being here. If you enjoyed it, let me know in the comment section and don't forget to like the video and subscribe and share the channel among your friends. Thank you and take care.